You know, the Old Testament is sometimes an intimidating book because it's so long and it covers a couple thousand years of history. So what I'd like to do is try to make it simple for you. I try to give you the overview. And really what the Old Testament is about, in a nutshell, is God picked a group of people to be his representatives in the world because he wanted to make himself known. Kind of like in the New Testament, Jesus said to the church, "You are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth." Well, in the Old Testament, God picked a group of people, the nation Israel, to be the salt of the earth, to be the light of the world, to show his character to the world. And if you understand that's what it's about, it's the story of a nation trying to represent God well. So back in the book of Genesis, God chose Abraham as the father of the Jewish people. God said to Abraham, "I'm going to make your name great. I'm going to give you a great nation, a great land. But most importantly, I'm going to make you a great blessing to all the nations of the earth." That was God's intention from the beginning, to use Abraham's descendants to be a great blessing to the world. Abraham had Isaac, and Isaac had Jacob. And by the time of Jacob, you're toward the end of the book of Genesis. Jacob was a guy who wrestled a lot with God. He struggled in his relationship with God. So God changed his name to "He Who Wrestles with God." Israel, that's what Israel means, the man who wrestles with God. Jacob was the patriarch of the nation Israel, and he had 12 sons, and they became the 12 tribes of Israel, which will be key to understanding the rest of the Old Testament. Those 12 sons, there was one named Joseph. Jacob favored Joseph, therefore the brothers were jealous, and they sold him as a slave into Egypt. They actually sold their brother as a slave. What's really interesting is Joseph became a picture of the Messiah who would come, because that brother who was rejected ended up being the savior of the entire people group. Here's how it happened. At the end of the book of Genesis, there's a famine, and all of the people have to go to Egypt to find food. And Joseph had been promoted to prime minister of Egypt, in charge of all the food supplies. So all the other brothers go down into Egypt. Joseph reveals himself to his brothers, and lo and behold, all of the 12 tribes, the 12 brothers, end up in Egypt at the end of the book of Genesis. That is really the first captivity of the nation Israel. They were in Egypt, and they grew to be a mighty nation. They were there for 400 years. And God had told Abraham, "I will make your descendants as the sand on the seashore in number." And that's what happened over those 400 years. They multiplied from just those 12 brothers and 12 tribes to be about 2 million people. Then at the end of the 400 years, God raised up a man named Moses to bring them out of Egypt. And that is the book of Exodus, which simply means the exit from Egypt. God used Moses to bring them out, the Passover, the plagues, the parting of the Red Sea, all of that, 2 million strong, came out of Egypt under the leadership of Moses. God brought that infant nation to the mountain called Sinai, Mount Sinai in the Sinai Peninsula out in the desert. And there God stopped them for an entire year. And he entered into a covenant relationship with them as a nation, that they would be his people. Just as God had said to Abraham, "Your people are going to be a great blessing to the whole world." Well, now God enters into a covenant relationship where he becomes their husband and they become his bride and his witnesses in the world. It's at Mount Sinai that they build a tabernacle or a temporary temple for God to live in, to dwell in their midst. And most importantly, it's at Mount Sinai that God gave to Israel the Ten Commandments. And not just the Ten Commandments, but hundreds of commandments. And really, this was the employee handbook for how they would serve as God's witnesses in the world. If they would live according to these commandments, they would represent God well to the world and show his character to the rest of the world. A key verse in the book of Exodus is chapter 19, verse 5 and 6, where God says, "If you obey these commandments, you will be my people, a holy nation of priests among all the nations, for all the earth is mine." So it's real clear from Exodus 19, 5 and 6, what God wanted to do is he wanted to make a whole nation of priests. And what does a priest do? A priest stands between God and man and brings the two together. And that was God's intention for the nation Israel from the very beginning and throughout the entire Old Testament, that they would be his representatives in the world. So after parking the nation Israel at Mount Sinai for 1 year and giving his commandments to them, they set out on a journey toward the promised land. Remember, God had said to Abraham, I'll give you a great nation, I'll give you a great land, and I'll make you a great blessing. That was the land of Palestine, or the land of Canaan. They set out on a journey that should have been just a month or two, but it ended up being a 40-year nightmare, disaster in the desert. Because these people disobeyed God over and over and over again. They began worshiping idols. Even Aaron, Moses' brother, made a golden calf for the people to worship at one point. So after they sinned numerous times, 10 times, rebelling against God, even asking if they could go back to Egypt, God finally said, that first generation, rest in peace. You're all going to die in the desert. And they did. That's why in the book of Numbers, there's two numberings or census of the nation Israel, one at the beginning and one at the end of that first generation. God wanted to make sure that all of that first generation was dead and gone. They died in the desert. Then God raised up a man named Joshua, and Joshua led Israel into the promised land. It took about 5 to 7 years for them to drive out the inhabitants to conquer the promised land. And then to divide it up. And each tribe, remember the 12 sons of Jacob became 12 tribes in Israel. Each tribe was given an allotted piece of land that they were to live on, that they were to protect, and from which they would be experiencing the blessing of God. By the end of the book of Joshua, Joshua challenged the nation because he could see even in his own generation this tendency for them to turn back to the gods of Egypt, to turn to idolatry, or maybe even to worship the gods that the people here, the Canaanites, had worshiped before the Israelites came in. Joshua gave a famous speech. He said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. But he told the Israelites, you must choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. But my house, we will serve the Lord. Joshua died. And then we come to the book of Judges. The book of Judges is about a 400-year time period where God raised up judges. They weren't kings over the nation. They weren't priests or spiritual leaders. They were a combination of a kind of political champion and a military champion. And God used these judges to deliver Israel time after time from oppression. What happens in the book of Judges, there's these seven cycles of sin. First, Israel is worshiping God, but then they turn away to idolatry. Then God brings oppression, a foreign oppressor, like the Philistines attack, or the Egyptians attack, or the Sidonians attack. Then Israel cries out in repentance to God, and then God sends a judge or a deliverer, like Gideon, or Samson, or Jephthah, or even Deborah was one of the great female judges, leaders. And they would deliver Israel. Then Israel would rejoice, and then they would have a period of 20, 30, maybe 40 years of prosperity and peace, and then they would sin again. Seven times in the book of Judges, we go through this cycle. And that is really what that book is all about, the cycles of sin and departure from God. The final sin was that the people demanded God give them a king, so that they could be like the other nations around them. You see, the reason God never gave them a king is because he wanted to be their king. It was called a theocracy, where God was their king. That's why he gave them judges instead of kings. God was to be their king. But their final great sin, under the leadership of Samuel, was that they cried out and said, we want a king like all the other nations. And so God said to Samuel, they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me. Give them their king. Their first king was a man named Saul, and he was a disaster. He was the kind of king that people wanted. He was a head taller than everyone else. He was handsome, but his character was lacking. He ruled for 40 years. The second king who followed Saul was David. And he is probably the most famous king of the Old Testament, the man after God's own heart, the man who wrote something like 70 of the Psalms in the Bible. Tremendous king. And then following David was his son Solomon. Solomon was unique. He was a man of wisdom. He wrote the book of Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. He was a very wise man, but the problem was he loved women more than he loved God. And he actually filled the temple that he built and that David planned. He filled that temple with idols to please his many wives. Consequently, God said to Solomon, I'm taking the kingdom and I'm going to rip it apart, and I'm going to give 10 tribes away to your opponent, and I'm going to only let 2 tribes remain with your son. And from that point forward, because of Solomon's divided heart, the kingdom of Israel became a divided kingdom throughout the rest of the Old Testament period. The 2 southern tribes were called Judah. The 10 northern tribes were called Israel. So after Solomon, the kingdom was divided, the south and the north. The south had a few good kings, but they had a lot of really bad kings as well who worshiped idols. The north had no good kings at all. They were completely apostate. They set up their own religion, their own temple, their own priesthood, their own religion that had nothing to do with the religion of their forefathers. What God did is he began to raise up prophets. The Hebrew word nabi means mouthpiece, the mouthpiece of God. And they were really like the covenant cops calling the nation back to obedience to the Mosaic covenant from Mount Sinai. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, they were the major prophets. And then there were a lot of minor prophets as well, smaller books of the Bible, like Jonah or Joel or Amos or Hosea. Through these covenant cops, God was calling the nation back to obedience, but they would not obey. Finally, in 722 BC, the northern kingdom finally met its end, falling to the Assyrians, and the 10 tribes went into captivity as a result of disobedience to God. If you go back to the law of Moses, that was the ultimate punishment for disobedience to the covenant. If the people failed to represent God well, God would expel them from their land, send them into captivity. That happened to the northern kingdom, Israel, in 722. And then it was in 586 BC that the other half, the southern kingdom, finally met its end, and they fell to the Babylonians who came. Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, he's talked about in the book of Daniel, came and destroyed Jerusalem, destroyed the temple, wiped out everything. They went into captivity. 70 years they were in captivity. God even raised up prophets in captivity. Daniel prophesied from within captivity. Ezekiel prophesied from within captivity. God was still calling out to his people, because you see, this discipline, this captivity, it was the hand of a loving God disciplining his people, not casting them off forever. At the end of 70 years, the 2 southern tribes, Judah and Benjamin, were released from captivity, and they were allowed to come back to their land and to rebuild. The books of Ezra and Nehemiah talk about the rebuilding of the city, the wall, and the temple. And a couple of the prophets like Haggai and Zechariah were raised up to encourage the people and speak to them. And then finally, when you come to 400 BC, you hear the last word from God through a prophet named Malachi, which his name actually means messenger, the messenger of God. And Malachi comes along and confronts the people on sins that are just like what they've been doing for 1,000 years. He calls them on covenant disobedience. Yet in the book of Malachi, God promises that someday he will send a forerunner who will come before the Messiah in the spirit and power of Elijah. He'll prepare the way for the Lord. And then, as Malachi prophesies, the Lord will come, and he will come in great power to meet his people and to rule the earth. And then the Old Testament goes silent. We go into the 400 silent years And that silence will be finally broken when Jesus is born into the world.